Hey, welcome, Riyandi.
Hi, present. Sorry, I have any technical difficulty before.
Hey, no problem.
Okay.
Can you share your screen?
Sure, let me share my screen first.
Yep, can you give me the projector more?
So I am presenting the correct.
Yeah,
okay.
I can see that. Okay, so you have roughly around 20 minutes for your session, and we'll keep a last couple of minutes for the Q&A. I'll come online and then.
Okay, thank you for the briefing. So hi everyone. So first of all, thank you for joining my session this time. So a bit of background of me. I'm Aryandi Widarto from Dana Indonesia. So Dana Indonesia is a payment platform, open payment platform in Indonesia. So if you ever use it, you can tell your feedback to me as well. And then what I usually do day to day is, as an architect engineer, I will do the planning and then the designing of the feature itself, and also collaborating with others department and so on. And then when I was asked for talking to this event, the theme of this event will be like connecting the digital stack. So I've been thinking for quite some time and finally got an idea to share about what I usually consider when I do the API design. So that's why the name of this topic is about the 359 degree of API design. So I do hope that this talk can cover most of the things that need to be considered when you do the API design. So before we start, I think I will give a bit of the sneak peek of today's session. So first, we will need to talk about the analogy of the API to connect the digital stack, and then a bit of briefing about that, and then we move to the what are the side effects if we don't do API design with proper consideration. And after that, we might need to take a look about what are the metrics to tell whether the API is good or bad. So based on that metrics, we can build up some measurement or some points what we need to do or we need to consider when we do the API design. So without further ado, let's continue the topic to the next one, which is the analogy. So in this analogy, you can imagine that a long time ago, before there was any technology like now, there is one person, and she is happened to be the founder of a company. So he have one friend, and he talked with her friend, which happened to be the engineer, and they talk each other, and long story short, they decide to build a company or to start a company. And they communicate each other, collaborate each other, and the company grow, and they can have more team and team member, and they talk about a lot of things inside of the company internally with the language. And then at one point, they aware that in order to grow more, the company need to interact each other with another company as well. So at that point, they will need to interact with another company, and this another company will also send some representative for each of the company, so they can communicate and interact with each other. So at this time, the medium of the communication will be the language. So a bit similar with the current situation. When we want to build a company, especially a tech company, we need to build the system part by part. So we need to build the first part, and then having the second part, the third part, and the last part. And after all the part has been completed, then the product is ready to launch, and we launch the product. But at some point, it's the same like building a company itself. We need to collaborate with other company. So the system will need to collaborate and interact with another system outside of the company. So in this era that we have the current technology, we do it with API instead of language. So we do it we do the communication between the system, even it is internal system with the API. So that's a bit of the analogy of the API itself to connect the digital stack. And so actually, what are the things that we need to consider? But bear with me a little bit longer for this part. So before we go to the things that we need to consider, I think we need to take a look about what is the cost or the side effects if we don't do proper API design. So there are two main side effects in this part. The first one will be the cost, and the second one will be the goals or the business goals. So the first one will be like this chart over there. So I believe at least one of you have ever seen this chart along the way somewhere. So basically, this chart is telling us that the cost of fixing the defects at the design phase is far more lower than at the production phase. So you can imagine that if we found the defects at the design phase, it's only like consuming the cost of one times only, because it's maybe just like the architect's time that will consume or waste by this defect. But when you do the when you find the defects at the development phase, the cost will be like 10 times from the design phase, because at the phase you will need to waste some of the time of the architects, the developers, the QA, and some other department as well. So the cost will slightly higher. And then if we find the bugs in the production phase, it will be like the cost will be far higher than the design or development phase. It will be like 150 times, because it will waste the user's times, the architect's time, developers, PMs, QAs, and any other department as well. So that's why we really need to think about what are the items that we need to cover when we do the API design. And then the second will be the business goal itself. So this is, I think, the most important part, because if we don't do proper API design, there will be like higher chance that the API itself cannot achieve the business goal that it need to cover. So we may need some extended time to complete the goal if we don't do the proper design. Okay, so that's all the side effects for not having a proper API design. And then when I create this presentation, the next thing that pop up into my mind is about so how we can tell whether the API is good or bad. So based on that, I built this chart which based on my personal experience and also a bit of Googling. So there is some metrics that we can use to check what are the whether the API is good or bad. So the first one is like number of API call for one business scenario. So the more number of API for one business scenario will make the interaction between systems become more complicated, and it is will be hard to implement by the developer itself. And then the second is the compatibility and extensibility. So of course, a good API design will be fully backward compatible when there is an older version of the API, and it should be made as easy as possible to be extended in the future. So in case the company grow and the business requirement grow, and we need to have more functionality of the API. And the next one will be the security aspect. So a good API should be the secure API. So I think that's also clear enough. And then the next one will be the user-friendly. For user-friendly, a good API specification should be easy to understand and easy to implement by any developer with certain common knowledge of the business itself. So we don't need to like explain everything from the start about this API in order to make the other developer understand. And then the last one will be the technical performance. So how good is the performance of the API? So it's related to the business target that you want to achieve, like how many TPS it could take. Is there like a monitoring dashboard that we can see to make sure that our API is still healthy and there is no issue on the API itself? And if there is any issue, is there any like stop bleeding mechanism or any limiter on the API itself? So based on this metrics, I came up with certain things that I usually consider when I do API design. So these are the things that I usually consider to tackle each of the metrics before. So for number of API calls, we have the first one is business requirement, and then it follows with the idempotent and concurrency logic. So we will talk a bit deeper about this after this slide. And then the second is about the compatibility and extensibility itself. So we need to ensure the backward compatibility and extensibility in the future. And then the next one, to cover the security, we can implement a lot of best practice and standards from the security. And for user-friendly, we can make like a standard for the API itself, and then we can document the API with a properly designed documentation, so it can be easy to read and understand. And then the last one is for technical performance. We need to think about how we're gonna test the API itself, and how we can check whether the performance is still good, or whether the performance we still need to be tuned. So that's the summarize of the things that I usually consider. Let's take a look a little deeper on each of the things. So the first one is business requirement. About business requirement, as the one who designed the API spec, we will need to really understand what are the business that will be covered by this API. For example, when it comes to the food ordering app, we may have the food rating from the reviewer capability. So we will need to think about all of the things from the very beginning, like starting from the user will order the food and then eat, drink, and pay for the food. And the last, the user will be able to review the food itself. So this kind of business requirement is really important to understand what kind of API needed in the API design itself. But the understanding of the business flow is not enough, because we also need to make sure that all of the things that we build is already comply with the business rules or the regulation. Like for example, we cannot just share or store any user sensitive data without user consent that has been given by the user themselves. So that's we need to understand the limitation, the constraint that follows the business requirement itself. And then the next one is the idempotent and concurrency. So idempotent is a mechanism to make sure that one unique transactional message can only be processed once, even if there is like a few trigger for the same unique transactional message. And then the concurrency is a mechanism to handle like there is any multiple invocation of API call at the same time. It's whether the API is the same unique transactional message or different transactional message. It doesn't matter, but this scenario can happen due to the network or system issue. Because like in the real world, there is no such guarantee that all the system and network will be running well 100%. So at some point, there must be some unexpected error occurred there and there. So idempotent and concurrency control is really important to be designed properly. It is very important, especially in the payment ecosystem. And then with the proper idempotent and concurrency control, another advantage that we can took is about with this mechanism, we can really do the self-recovery method from the system point of view. So if there is any issue occur since the system starting, the system can just retry the process with ease because we already handled the idempotent and concurrency. So if there is any retry, the system can just like, oh, this is the same request. We can just return the latest status or the information that needed by this API. So that kind of thing is really important for the business like a payment. And then the next is about compatibility and extensibility. So as I mentioned before, it will be the best if we could design our API spec to be 100% backward compatible. And then of course it's also be better if the API spec can be reused in the longer run in the future. But of course life will never be perfect. So under certain circumstances, we cannot achieve 100% backward compatibility or extensibility, then the last option is we need to do API migration. Of course, we also need to design the migration as well with care and provide the bulletproof migration steps to prevent any incident happens in the migration itself. Because maybe migration is a bit harder, especially when there is like zero downtime requirement from the product itself. So it is a lot. There are a lot of things need to be considered when we do the migration with zero downtime expectation. So to do the migration, we need to have like some kind of the monitoring so we can monitor the migration is successful or not. And then we need to do it by grayscale so we can like put whitelist to the users that we want to migrate first as a tester. And then we also need to have rollback capability. That's the really important part, because if anything goes out, then we need to make sure that we can roll back the changes as soon as possible. So next topic is about security. Since I'm not an expert about the security, but I will try just to mention a bit about this part. So nowadays, there is a lot of best practice in security that we can use to make our API a lot secure, a lot more secure. So for example, in this image, there is the first one is about the asymmetric digital signature. It is used to guarantee the authenticity of the message and also to guarantee the non-repudiation of the message itself. And then there is like OAuth 2.0, where this mechanism can support three-party data sharing with user consent. And we also need to implement a proper access management to ensure that everyone only got the access to what they supposed to have. So that's the key point of the security, right? And then there's a lot of other things about security that I could not mention one by one, like HTTPS, IP whitelist, sensitive data encryption, and so on. So next is about the standard and documentation. So when we design our API specification, we need to make it like more user-friendly for someone who want to implement it. So what really important is the convention such as naming itself, the path, the HTTP method, and the header, body format, also the timeouts and the logging is really important. So when there is a new developer join the team, we can just present the documentation about the standards and he can swim more freely in the API specification that already exists before. And then of course, all of that information need to be documented properly so that the developer that want to implement or want to learn about the API itself can understand it clearly without any much guidance from the API owner. So this documentation will be very useful for internal team as well, because when there is new team member join, she or he can just read the API documentation itself. And at the end, it will also reduce the time that we waste on explaining the API again and again and again. And then after all the previous things, we need to start thinking about the testing consideration. So when we design the API, we also need to consider the testing part, although that this part could be done later. We'll need to cover all of the possible test cases, like positive cases, negative, idempotent, and concurrency. And we also need to make sure that our API is working 100% well and bulletproof from any scenario that mentioned before. And last but not least, we also need to do the performance testing, like a load testing and A/B testing, to make sure that the performance of our API is acceptable to the market. And then the last one is monitoring and tuning. We will need to know the information about the TPS target to prepare what kind of performance we want to build. And then it is always better if we can provide limiter or switch capability as a mitigation plan in case we want to disable or limit the API itself, so the API can fail gracefully. And then we also need to prepare the monitoring dashboard so we can know the performance itself. And the last, I think we'll need to have technical improvement when the TPS target is improved or increased when the business grows. And that's all about the presentation today. So basically, this is what we talk about today, about the metrics of the API design, and then the things that are usually considered, start from the business requirement, idempotent, and security, and so other. And so I think that's all what I can share this time. It is quite a lot of things to consider, but big things always have small beginnings. So in most of the case, what we really need is only to create an MVP version of the API itself. So we don't need to wait until all the things has been perfectly set in place. Although it is good if we can have that one as early as possible.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Thanks, Ariandi.
Okay.
I'm sure the startup ecosystem in Indonesia will greatly benefit from your experience-based insights. Please, are you giving us the consent to share these decks with the audience?
Sure. I will send you the details about the presentation.
Sure, then please do add your contact details so that the audience can reach out to you when required for any assistance with queries.
Okay, thank you.
Yep, thanks a lot.